Alright everyone, welcome back to Cody's Lab. So a lot of you seem to enjoy my video on cesium tungstate, the salt that when dissolved in water makes a liquid that is dense enough that it can float rock. And so I think I will do a few more videos on the subject. Today I'll be making the densest water-based liquid that I know of, and that is Clerici's solution. This is actually two salts dissolved in water, and both of them are thallium-based. Thallium, of course, is well known for its use as rat poison because its salts are tasteless, odorless, and incredibly soluble in water, which makes it very useful for making dense liquids, but also incredibly toxic. But I should be alright as long as I don't try to eat it and also keep it off my skin whenever possible. So without further ado, let's crack this jar open and see how it looks. This is a sample of thallium that I bought for my element collection a few years ago. As you can see, it's inside of a tin can and packed with vermiculite because thallium is that toxic. It's not really something you want to get out into the environment. The lethal dose of thallium is about the same as the lethal dose of mercury, but thallium, I would say, is more toxic than mercury because this stuff is a known carcinogen, whereas mercury is not. So anyway, let's get one of these chunks out of there and see if we can make a super heavy liquid. Get all that mineral oil off of it so I know exactly how much I have. I've worked out that I need 1.5 grams of formic acid and 3.4 grams of malonic acid. So let's weigh them out. I'm gonna call that good. So there's our acids. Now all I'm going to do is mix them together along with a little bit of water and use this to dissolve my piece of thallium. That could take a while, and I think I'm going to do it in an area with a little bit better ventilation. Fun fact, one of the antidotes to thallium poisoning is actually Prussian blue, a cyanide compound. I found that rather amusing. But anyway, it didn't seem to react until I got the solution very hot, and at those temperatures the formic acid would want to leave, so I put a cover over it to help reflux the acid back. But there we go, it's finally reacting. Now I guess I'll just let it sit here for a few hours. I might eventually cut this ingot in half just to make it go a little faster. There you go. So here we are, about 2 days and some change since my last cut. You can see I put some fiberglass in here to maintain some heat. I think most of it is dissolved now, so let's have a look. Just pull that up, set that over there. So yeah, there's still some pieces left. I eventually took my knife and actually cut the thallium into little chunks, and that made it dissolve quite a bit faster. And as you can see, I'd say around 80% of it was dissolved. So I think I'm going to call that good enough. I'm going to take this out of there. Let's just pour it off into this large beaker to evaporate. After evaporating down, this is what I'm left with. A material that looks a lot like melted sugar, which is slowly crystallizing from the sides, if you can see there. So now I'm going to add a little bit of water back, pretty much drop wise, just enough to get it to the point where it's mobile again. So a couple of drops and let it dissolve. There we go. I believe I got it mobilized. That's definitely a liquid. It's amazing when you think about how that piece of thallium metal is actually right here in the solution. Anyway, let's take a diamond and put it into the solution. You remember a diamond sank in the cesium tungstate? Let's see what it does in this thallium solution. There you go. Diamond floats. Now that is cool. Ooh, almost lost it there. Excellent. Let's see what else it'll float. Diamond has a density of about 3.5 grams per cubic centimeter, and this piece of corundum has a density of about 4. Okay, just give that a little shake, make sure it's floating, and it is. Look at that. That is corundum floating on liquid. Next, let's try a piece of barite, or barium sulfate. I believe this has a density of 4.5. Let's see if it'll float. Oh, it sinks. Okay, I guess I expected that because this solution should have a density of about 4.25 grams per cubic centimeter. So 4.5 obviously sank. But there you go. By now you guys have probably guessed that this solution is very useful for measuring the density of different minerals to figure out exactly what you have. For instance, you could put your sample into the solution, add water until it is neutrally buoyant, and then from there calculate the density to figure out what mineral you've got. Today though, I'm just going to do a sink or swim analysis to see whether I have diamond or cubic zirconia. Let's put in the diamond. Now, of course, you guys know that one floats. And now the rock that I suspect to be zirconium dioxide. Did it sink? It sank. There you go. Cubic zirconia has a density of around 6 grams per cubic centimeter, so it sank in the solution that is 4.25. And the diamond, of course, being 3.5, floated. So there you go. That is cubic zirconia. So there you have it. Possibly the heaviest aqueous solution in the world. I think you could go a little bit heavier if you maybe added a couple more ions, took advantage of the multiple ion effect a little bit better, or used heavy water instead of normal water. But I can't imagine going more than a couple of percent heavier than this. This is possibly, you know, this is approaching the limit to what you can achieve with aqueous solutions. I think in the next video on the subject, I'm actually going to go for a little bit lighter solution and one that's not nearly so toxic. So hope you'll stay tuned for that. Hope you enjoyed this video, and I'll see you next time.